everyone, it's Jen and welcome back. I was watching back my video yesterday and I realized that I didn't do the reviews that I told you I was going to do on my Monday update. And that's probably because I had several books to show you. So I decided what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a new feature. So during the week, I'm going to put up just a short video about the books that I've read the previous week or on the weekend and give you just short reviews of what I think of them. No spoilers or anything like that. They'll probably either go up on Tuesdays or Wednesdays, so I'm going to do that. And then I also went to the library last night and I picked up a few books, so I don't think that's going to be a weekly feature, but every time I make a library trip and pick up some things, I will film those as a separate video so you can see what I picked up and what my thoughts are on why I picked those up rather than buy them. So let's get started. So one of the books that I read last week was Juniper, and as I mentioned in my previous video, that Juniper is the story of a micro preemie. She was born very early, barely old enough or enough gestation to sustain life. So I had some mixed feelings on this book. It is a nonfiction, so there's no spoilers or anything to give. You know right away that Juniper survives, but it's basically the story of her survival and what her parents and her had to go through for months and months and months while they were trying to just get her to remain living. And it was such a touching book in some places. When she was born, her father went to go see her and he could not even touch her because if he touched her skin in a certain way, it would come off. And I can't even imagine that. Like, how could you not touch your own child? And how could they just be so incredibly delicate that their skin would come off? So there were some parts of the book that were just so enlightening and makes you really thankful for, you know, what you have. And if you've not experienced this kind of thing, that you haven't experienced it, you know, thankful for the beautiful child that you have, and that they didn't have to go through the trials and tribulations that micro preemies or preemies have to go through. One of my really good friends had a preemie, and I know that he was in the NICU for several months, and I can't even imagine going through that. Now, my son was in the NICU, but it was only for a few days. But it was still a traumatic experience to me because I didn't expect that he was going to have to go to the NICU. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Well, let's talk about it now. So the mother in the story, she was the downfall for me. She was so immature. I couldn't get her. I couldn't connect with her. I felt in the beginning that the father was also immature, even though he was older than his wife. The father had already had two grown sons, so he had experience with parenthood. The mother had no children, and their relationship was rocky, to say the least, from the very start. And throughout the book, every time something happened, she, the mother, constantly, Kelly is her name and Tom is the father, Kelly constantly would be like, oh, he's going to leave me now. Oh, this happened, he's going to leave me now. I don't know about you guys, but every time something happens in my life, I don't constantly think Frank is going to leave me. And maybe that's because we have a really strong relationship, but I would think most people would be on a foundation where they don't think the slightest thing is going to make their husband leave. Secondly, I just found some really annoying things about this. So I have mentioned to you previously that I was told I couldn't have children, and Amelia was a total surprise to us. They had told us we had to go for fertility treatments and the whole nine yards, and I just decided that that wasn't for me. I really, you know, prayed about it and thought about it, and I don't condemn anybody that goes for any of those treatments or has a surrogate or anything like that. It's just, for me personally, that wasn't the road that I wanted to go down. I have enough ailments that I just didn't want to add more things that was going to make my body go haywire. So we never did that. But this Tom and Kelly had to do that. And in the end, none of her in vitros worked out. I believe she had miscarriages. And she ended up having to have donated eggs in order for her to carry Juniper. And she went through years and years of trouble and heartache and heartbreak in order to get pregnant with this little baby. And she gets pregnant with her and then immediately does careless things that ultimately led her to have this baby at 23, 24 weeks. And Tom had warned her not to do these things. And she was just like, yeah, whatever. And this is what happened. And I was like, okay. Another thing that really annoyed me was when she went for an ultrasound to find out the baby's gender. And they originally told her it was going to be a boy. And she was like sitting on the table, like ready to cry and thinking how she was going to deal with this. And I was like, really, woman? I mean, I don't know. When you're a parent, especially when you're in a situation where you think you can't have a baby and you magically, or not magically, but, you know, get pregnant, that's not the first thought that goes through your mind that, oh, darn it, I'm having a boy or a girl. I really wanted one of the other. You know, like, who does that? I don't know. It just seemed so immature. You know, this is a little personal thing about me, but when I was pregnant with Emilio, I had a horrible pregnancy because it seemed like one after another things went wrong. And they told me he was going to have multiple things wrong with him. Thank God he's a beautiful, normal baby boy. But over the, you know, I would say it was from between like the beginning till about 23 weeks, I constantly was being told things were wrong. And when that happens, and when you don't think you can have a child, your first thought is not about the gender. Like, yes, you want to know what the gender is, but all you want is a healthy baby. And it floored me that this woman was more concerned about having a boy or a girl than having a healthy baby. Like, it just bothered me. And also, when they did finally realize it was a girl, she was laying on the table and said, oh, thank God. Like, really, woman? Get your priorities straight. And then the last thing that really annoyed me about it was when she was in the hospital after Juniper was born. Now, obviously, we know this baby's having tubes in and out of her. She's in a very precarious state. It's, you know, life and death every minute with babies that are born this young. And this woman refused to get out of bed at times and wouldn't go to the NICU to see the baby because it was too much for her. She refused to give the baby a name because she didn't want to think about it. Not because she was afraid that she didn't want to give ownership to the baby or it would be worse for her. Or at least if that was the case, she didn't relay that in this book. She just was too lazy to think about it. And what was the other thing? Oh, and she was so resentful of babies that were born normally that when she walked past the regular nursery and the babies were crying, which is what babies do, she called them fatties and said that, why do you have any right to complain, fatty? There's nothing wrong with you. Honestly, really? Like, guys, if you've had experience with a preemie baby or a baby that was in the NICU, baby was very sick, I really highly doubt any of you walked through the nursery and was resentful of healthy babies. I know I sure wasn't. I loved looking at the babies, even though mine was in the NICU. I just couldn't get over that. And I think that I wanted to put this out there for anybody that really wanted to read this book that might have had experience with this kind of situation, that shit is going to really annoy you because you're just so thankful you have a baby that is, you know, thriving and living and, you know, you've been through the situation. I can understand everybody deals and copes with things in different ways, but I felt like she was just so immature and she didn't grow at all through any of the books. She didn't. Tom totally did. And that was one thing that kept me reading is I really enjoyed seeing how he saw how precious life was and how different he needed to be and think in order to cope with this situation. But she was never there for Tom at all. Never, never. He had to support her the whole entire time. So I don't think it was a bad book. I actually think it was really good. And if you skip over the Kelly parts where, of course, she's trying to be snarky, but it just comes off as, like, rude. If you skip over her parts and just read the parts about Juniper and her struggle for life and the parts about her dad, it's beautiful. So there is that, and I think I gave it 3 stars because of that. So the other reviews are going to be shorter than that one, but that one really pissed me off in some places, so I had to talk a little bit more about that one. The next one that I showed you guys and that I read is Leslie Meyer. This is The British Manor Murder. And by the way, I got all these books for review. So I have to say this one was not my favorite of hers. Actually, it was probably my least favorite of hers. I did not enjoy the writing as much as I usually do. I know that I particularly am fond of her books that have to do with the holidays, like the Trick or Treat Murder, the Candy Corn Murder, you know, like the holiday ones, obviously. But this one was just very different than all the other Lucy Stone murders that I've read. And I had to tell somebody the other day that said they were interested in reading this book because of the dogs. These are they corgis or corgis? I'm not sure how to pronounce it, but those are the dogs that the Queen owns. And the person had said to me that they wanted to read it because obviously the dogs are in there. Well, those dogs aren't even in the book. So if you're going to read it for that reason, don't, because there's none of those dogs in the book. They're Labradors and they're both male. So I don't know where the cover artist got this from, but it has nothing to do with it. The murder takes place in the beginning and is like totally glossed over until a second murder happens, and then nothing even really happens with that until like the last 15% of the book. It was very odd, and I would say if you're not a Leslie Meyer fan, probably don't pick this one up. If you are a Leslie Meyer fan, you might enjoy it just because you enjoy reading her books, but this was definitely my least favorite of all the ones I've read of hers. And then the last one that I read this week was this one, and I mentioned this yesterday. This is The Christmas Angel Project by Melody Carlson. I really enjoyed this one. I gave it 4 stars, and that's because I'm a big fan of Melody Carlson, but probably it was more like a 3.5. I did enjoy it, and the more that I thought about it, I know I had said yesterday that it was a 5-star read, but the more that I thought about it and had to reflect on it and think of it more like just a standalone book rather than just being a fan of Melody Carlson, this one's more like a 3.5. The story is about 5 women who are in a book club, and the main character, or the main person in the book club, the glue that holds everyone together, she passes away, and the 4 women that are left don't know what to do with themselves, basically. And the woman leaves a gift behind for them, and it inspires them to do wonderful works for people. I felt like the story was very loose in this one. There were not a lot of ends that should have been tied up. There was one particular part when I got to the end of it that I really liked, and I felt myself really engage with that and like clench onto it. But the rest of it, I kind of felt like I was just not as engaged as I have been with her books. Usually I'll just finish her books in one sitting. This one took me a couple of times, and it's not that long at all. It doesn't have a strong Christmas aspect in it, which you would think so because of the title. I mean, it is around Christmas time, but I don't know. It was just missing something. It was missing that magic that her other books have. It was kind of just women going through their lives and doing these things, and although they were doing them for good, like I said, it was just missing that magic. So, I mean, like I said, it was like 3.5, 3 stars. The end part I really liked that had to do with pets. But it's just okay. Like, I would say, you know, if you are really interested in it, pick it up. If not, then you could skip it and you really wouldn't be missing too much. So, unfortunately, all 3 of these ones were kind of bummers for me, except, like I did say, I did enjoy Juniper, some parts of it. Some parts of it I really liked, but this one, yeah, I would say if you're interested in Melody Carlson, definitely pick up The Christmas Dog and The Christmas Bus. Those were 2 of my favorites, but I enjoyed, like, several of her books last year. So, there's that. So, those are my 3 reviews for this week. It turned out to be a long video again because I had to rant about Juniper, but I want to thank you guys for joining me today, and as always, happy reading.